Hello, my name is Gábor Kis, and today I will talk about exchange rate systems. So, when the exchange rate regime is selected by a country, actually they can balance between two different schools and approaches. One says that exchange rate and the value of the currency should be defined by the state. Or maybe it should be defined by the reserves, so what kind of currency reserve or gold reserve were they able to accumulate in the past, and now this is the defines the value of the currency. The other says, and this is quite a recent one, so we have this only since the 70s, so this is highly a new, relatively new approach, since the first school is all before, so thousands years old. So the second school says that actually it should be defined by the market. So let's say that market forces will determine the value of the currency based on the internal balance, based on the external balance of the currency, so inflation and the balance of payment position, capital movements will provide enough information for the market that they will be able to price this in. Obviously, these are completely different approaches. So if you are looking on the map right now, then we can see that, oh, there are completely different approaches. Actually, I recommend you this RAR report, which is published by the IMF. So if you are checking the internet, we can see that these are yearly annual reports, and we can find it from 2000 until 2019. They are publishing once in a year, and here we can see in the most recent report that even there are some countries which don't have any kind of individual currency. So yeah, once I started to move the right one, so we can see that there is no separate legal tender, means that they are using US dollar as an official currency in Panama or in Ecuador, and so on. Or they are using euro as an official currency, like in Kosovo, Montenegro, San Marino, or other, maybe Australian dollar, I don't know, but maybe, yeah. Or they can say that, okay, we are using currency board. This is what I mentioned, that you are using your reserve. So you are accumulating US dollar in this case, or euro in the other case, and after that your currency will be issued as a ratio of this reserve. So practically you could say that, okay, you can exchange freely your this currency against US dollar or euro, because we are issuing it as a percentage of the official reserve. But it's really hard, because you have to manage this, you have to keep track that how the money demand will appear on the market, so it's highly hand-managed market, so it's really hard to do it in real or big enough economies. So you can see here only small economies. That's why we can say that the most popular is the conventional bank. So this is the fixed exchange rate. And we can see here the most countries, so 42 countries from 2 years ago. So let's define this. So in this case, we can say that exchange rate anchor means that the monetary authority, so central bank, buys or sells foreign exchange to maintain the exchange rate. So this is what we can call as intervention. So if they intervene, that they would like to step in, and if they are able to see that there is an imbalance between the supply and the demand side of the currency market, because still there is a currency market even under fixed exchange rate, then they will step in and they will manage it by hand. That okay, they can say that okay, if people would like to sell the currency and it would create depreciation, then we start to buy, so we start to sell foreign currency, the other currency, and obviously foreign exchange reserve limits this ability. Later on, then we'll be talking about theories about exchange rates. We can see that that's why indirect intervention, so interest rate policy, will have much bigger power because you are not able to run out interest rates so easily. So this is the. And also, this nominal Uncle rule means that actually exchange rate defines the purchasing value of the domestic currency at some level, so import prices, ability to import goods, ability to import capital will be also affected by this. So even if your central bank says that we don't care about exchange rate, let's define it by market forces, still they can't forget about this. And so let's see. Conventional bank. So in this case, fixed currency system means that actually, officially, they are defining an exchange rate, and or sometimes not just against one currency, but against a basket of currencies. Why basket is better? Because obviously, if you are fixing only one against one currency, then if the other currency appreciates or depreciates, your currency will appreciate and depreciate also against other currencies as well. And it can be the problem. So if you have two main markets, let's say US and the Euro zone, and you are fixing only your currency against the Euro, and the Euro starts to appreciate against the US dollar, then actually you start to lose your competitiveness on the US market because you are appreciating. So that's why basket can be better, because in this case, the movement of key currencies can be zeroed out. And also, IMF should be notified about this. And actually, that's why I prefer also this Aria report, because they are not just focusing on official systems. Because officially you can define many things, you can declare that what you prefer, but this report focuses on the de facto, so what is happening in real life on the market. Because sometimes countries can say that okay, we would like to maintain an exchange rate, but they are not able to do that because it's not credible. And what is the fluctuation band here? So we can see that the fluctuation band is actually really narrow. So still, market supply and demand has some degree of freedom, but plus minus 1%, or sometimes it's 2%, but it's absolutely narrow. So in this case, you have to have really stable and reliable supply and demand side still. You have to be credible. You have to have foreign exchange reserves. You have to guide your entire interest rate policy to serve this desired exchange rate to maintain these indirect interventions. And also, you have to maintain a smooth balance of payment balance. So your current account should be balanced. Otherwise, if something wrong happens, then this will fall to pieces. Unfortunately, we can find more examples for disastrous fixed system than examples for long-term, so decade-long operations when actually market was able to sustain it and the central bank was able to sustain this. So they became rigid. So maybe you are defining it right now and you are in balance and so on, but as time passes, your country changes, your economy changes, maybe the entire environment changes completely. So the entire Bretton Woods system, that we will learn later on, was focusing on the fixed exchange rate between the gold and the US dollar, and the US dollar and between Western European currencies. And it was only operational between the end of the Second World War and the 70s, so for 30 years. And they were the most advanced economies at that time. So that's why I'm always skeptic about this, because this never ends well. Always we learn about it that, oh, there was a crisis related to fixed exchange rate. Stabilized arrangement is different because in this case you don't have a mandatory exchange rate. You are saying that, okay, we would like to keep around this, or maybe they are defining a ceiling for the currency. So they are saying that, okay, we are not allowing the exchange rate to appreciate further than this level, like it happened in Switzerland between 2011 and 2015, when they had this 1.2 Swiss franc to euro exchange rate ceiling, and Czech Republic also had a similar thing between 2013 and 17 maybe, or 18, something like this. So it's less strict, and it's absolutely temporary. Crawling peg. Crawling peg is also a really useful tool for consolidation. So why you don't know that what should be your exchange rate? In many cases, because you are changing your institutional environment, or there was a huge external shock, and you know that, okay, currency should be depreciating, but you don't want to give it completely to the market to define the exchange rate, because it creates even bigger shocks. So you are saying that, okay, let's calm down the market. Let's say that, okay, we are saying that, yeah, we should depreciate the currency, but you are defining the ratio of depreciation, and in this case you are defining the monthly depreciation, and after that you can, or market players can say that, okay, on daily basis what is happening there, and you are defining a fluctuation band around it, and it can be highly effective. So you can see at for example in Hungary, when they introduced crawling peg in the middle of the 90s, it was able to reduce the inflation level from 30% a year to 10% a year, because it was credible. Obviously, there was a huge problem at that time, because all the institutional system had to be changed, all the foreign external market had to be changed, all the capital movements had to be changed, all the state had to be consolidated, so there were many consolidational issues by turning from a post-socialist country to a market-oriented and European, Western Europe-oriented economy. But crawling peg can be a useful tool, so actually all the regional countries used at one point or another such a crawling peg scheme. And yeah, what are the pros and cons for this system? So first of all, it can be useful because there is no exchange rate risk. That's why it's highly preferred, because your exporters, your importers don't have to be afraid. The capital exporters don't have to be afraid that, okay, they are building something here or purchasing some bonds, that the next day it will lose some percentage of the value because of exchange rate fluctuations. And also, the problem is that it's fragile. I mentioned it, that you are completely captured. So the entire monetary policy, and sometimes even the fiscal policy, will be the subject of this to maintain the exchange rate, because you need foreign exchange reserves, you need external balance, you are not able to have high inflation, your interest rates will be guided by this thing, so it never ends well. So that's why in the 70s, advanced economies, and later on after the different crises in the 90s, even emerging economies realize that floating may be a better option, because floating exchange rates will be determined by market. So if we are going back to the ARIA report, you can see that crawling peg, for example, it was, or crawl-like arrangements or stabilizer arrangements, which are these interim issues, they are also used by some of the countries, but we can see that floating, free floating, which are relatively the same. So floating means that still you can have a 15% fluctuation band, but it gives you a huge degree of freedom. And we can see here the majority of, or the other half of the planet, and most or all of the advanced economies, and even most of the emerging economies. So floating. In this case, still we can look on the different benchmarks. So what should happen with the exchange rate? So still we can look for the premium between the domestic and foreign interest rates. Still we can look for the difference between domestic and foreign inflation. Still we can look on the position of the balance of payments, growth prospects, and so on. But in this case, exchange rate will act as a stabilizer, automatic stabilizer. So if there is an external shock, obviously the exchange rate will react on it instantly. But after that, it helps you to stabilize the economy, so you don't have to increase your interest rate to avoid this shock, because, oh my god, my exchange rate would otherwise depreciate, because there is a sudden recession on the market, and you will be not the subject of this anymore. So this can be nice. The problem is that with this regime, you are pushing all the problems of exchange rate fluctuation from macro level down to micro level. So you are saying that under fixed exchange rate, you are saying that, oh, I can do this, I am the state, I am the central bank, we will do this. Under floating regime, you are saying that, well, it's up to the market forces, so dear companies, you can do it on your own. So that's the reason that all the financial innovations were introduced after the 70s or during the 70s, so foreign exchange rate options, swap agreements, forward and future contracts, all of them were created and defined or became popular after this time period, because companies still need to survive under volatile exchange rates. And this volatility can be really significant sometimes. So on during the next semester on international financial management, we will learn about this. We will learn many things, so how companies can be affected by exchange rates and how they can hedge this, and what are the expenditures. So it's a really interesting phenomenon, because actually if you have floating exchange rate, then actually you can say that, okay, if you are not part of the Eurozone, let's say you are in Hungary or in Czechia or in Denmark, then what is the price of not joining the Eurozone, not having a fixed exchange rate system? Because in this case, you can say that, okay, let's calculate the option fees for which covers all the export and all the imports, so deals with the foreign trade, and then on an annual basis we can calculate it. Okay, that would be the price. And advantage that you don't have to. Your entire monetary policy can focus on domestic issues, so mostly they are focusing on inflation. Inflation targeting can be used, and this is way more flexible. So as I mentioned, that usually it did not end it well for emerging economies to pursue this peg or fixed exchange rate systems, and all of them landed sooner or later at floating regimes. And actually, after that, still they were able to operate well. We can say that, oh, but what happened with import prices? Because if currencies depreciating, for example, imported goods prices will increase. But during the last chapter, I will talk about emerging economies and open economies. And there is a huge evidence from the last 20 years that actually the importance of import prices in domestic inflation is decreasing even in the emerging economies. Okay, right now we are in a really low inflation period and even a deflationary period during the last at least one decade or now one and a half, nearly two decades. So we can say that this is not a big deal right now. Yeah, dollarization, I mentioned it already, so they have no legal tender and no official currency. So the question is, which regime can be adequate for a country? Which one is the best? I like this. No, there is no best solution. So there can be adequate solution. Maybe they are nice or the other. But we can say that this one is the better one, this one is the Ferrari, and this one is the Trabant. So, floating regime. If you have a stable economy, so there is not so big current account deficit, or even if you have deficit, then you have financial account surplus, micromanagement is also happening. So mostly, and your public debt and the external debt is relatively small. So mostly your debt is financed from domestic sources. Then actually, it can be stable. So you don't have to be afraid that, oh my god, what is happening with the foreign or with the floating regime, because you are robust enough. Also, if your credit rating is good enough, then capital flows are always coming in, so you can be even accounted as a safe haven. And anti-inflation in the pegging system, I mentioned it already that it can be misleading, and it was misleading in the Mexican crisis, in the Argentinian crisis, in the Brazil crisis. So we can name many crisis situations from the 90s when they were saying that, oh, we are using fixed exchange rate systems because it's good against inflation, then they went to default several years later. And crawling peg, I mentioned it already that it works. It's a way of stabilizing exchange rates. So I told about this already. We can see some examples. Actually, this is a really good article. And how about appreciation? So appreciation can be good against inflation, bad for competitiveness. But actually, it's also not a big deal. So until your appreciation is, the level of appreciation is smaller than the growth of productivity in your economy, actually it doesn't matter. So for example, Czech koruna appreciates since the middle of the 90s. So if we are looking on the stoku.com, I recommend you this. Because it's a free database made by a Polish company. And so here we can say that, let's see, the last 30 years. So the Czech koruna was constantly appreciating. But can we say that, oh my god, it created some distortion in the Czech economy? No, it's not, because they were also growing, their productivity was also improving, so it was not a problem for them. So in many cases, we can say that maybe you want to slow it down. So appreciation can be a problem. When it's sudden, so when it's not gradual, but it happens from one night to another, like it happened in Switzerland. So here we can see that yeah, it is really sudden. So from 0.60 something, it was jumping to 0.8 and above. So obviously the central bank had to slow it down. So that was this buffer peg what I mentioned already, that they were not allowing above this level. And once they were freeing it, then it skyrocketed again. So this is unhealthy, obviously, and this did not happen once, it's actually the second issue. So let's say 50 years. So we can see that under the inflationary periods or stagflationary periods of the 70s, Swiss franc was also appreciating dramatically. So it's actually the second wave what we can see here. And this is destructive. So this is not because of the healthy growth of the economy, the productivity growth, because it's because of market fear, because they would like to purchase safe assets. So this is the flight to safety. And we could say that, oh, it's a first world problem, but still, if you are head of the central bank, you have to do something with that. So let's see some anomalies here. So first of all, asset price bubbles can happen. And yeah, there is a huge debate in the economies that what you can do against asset price bubbles, because central banks have an obvious focus on the consumption prices and not on asset prices, because asset prices are completely the subject of the business cycles and also funding conditions, which should be also the subject of business cycles. And if the bubble increases, central banks can increase the interest rates to slow down the formation of the bubble, but this degree of freedom is questionable. So there was this Greenspan put which said, he stated in the early 2000s that if there is a asset price bubble, then central bank cannot do many things against it. Increasing interest rates sooner or later, but once they are able to see it and once they start to increase the interest rate, usually the bubble bursts, and then you have to decrease the interest rate gradually to mop the entire thing up. Fear of floating. If you are a small and open economy, I mentioned that import prices can be an issue, and that's why we can see, and there is a huge evidence from the literature that many countries are still focusing, half focusing with their one eye on the exchange rate. So regardless that they are saying that okay, our currency is free floating, but also at the same time we can say that okay, but reserve volatility is higher than should be, interest rate volatility is also high, monetary aggregate volatility is also high. And it's not supposed to happen under free floating. And also, if you can see that exchange rate and interest rate correlation is strongly positive or negative, then we can say that they are trying to manage, just they don't have the jure objective, which is makes their situation easier. Exchange market pressure. Actually, it means that you can create exchange market pressure index to see that are you under pressure or not because of market forces. And actually here we can see one index, our colleague Szalonda Plucze works on this topic, and he now has a paper on this field. And you can see here that this index can be calculated based on the changes of the exchange rate, based on the volatility of the exchange rate, based on the exchange volatility of the reserves, monetary aggregates, and the interest rate differential, and also the volatility of the interest rate. So actually, this fear of floating can be captured by this exchange market pressure thing. Safe haven currency. So if the currency behaves like gold, so gold is always preferred under recession, under high inflation periods, or once people are afraid on the market of something. In this case, not just gold or silver or other precious metals starts to increase, but also they start to move in to currencies like Swiss franc, what I mentioned before, or sometimes also to Canadian dollar, Norwegian krona, Swiss krona, Danish krona. So into currencies where inflation is really low, they have really stable institutional background, and also that's all what we can say here. And that their credit rating is excellent. We have the carry trade. So it means that we are taking up a loan in a safe haven currency, because in this case the interest rates are really low and the inflation is also really low. Then we take this money and purchase and invest this money into emerging assets. Like I will purchase a Hungarian or Polish or South African or Turkish government bond from this. And after that, I will realize my profits from the interest rate differential between the two currencies. And not just the interest rate differential, it's necessary to have low inflation in both cases, or at least the real interest rate should be still bigger, and also the volatility of the exchange rate should be low. So once volatility starts to increase, these carry trade positions are falling to pieces, and actually it reduces the purchasing or the demand for the currency, for the demand for the emerging currency. So suddenly this upward pressure on the emerging currency disappears. So actually their depreciation will be stronger than before. And also there was a downward pressure on the safe haven currency, and once it disappears, then they start to appreciate as well. So carry trade is acting against obvious market forces, but once it disappears, actually it makes even bigger mess than before. Flight to safety, I mentioned it already, that in case of trouble, you start to purchase safe assets. Yeah. So, shocks. We can say that shocks can be determined by the following ways. So, funding suddenly withdrawn, liquidity rapidly disappears, and there will be concerns about solvency, or leverage, so maintaining debt structure will be a problem. Collapsing risk appetite means that actually the demand for riskier bonds will disappear on the market or decrease on the market, counterparty risk increases, and also market liquidity completely decreases. Later on we will be talking about liquidity, because it's even necessary to define. And so market will dry up, and funding in mediocre or lower credit rating countries and companies will reduce, which means that bond yields will increase and currencies will depreciate. Okay, so let's stop here and see.